To me, a misconception is a piece of information that is being used and used again, and quite often, you know, taken out of context, and that is not necessarily portraying the reality.
Hi everyone, my name is Boyan Slat. I'm the founder and CEO at The Ocean Cleanup, and today I'm here with
Laurent Lebreton. I'm the head of research for The Ocean Cleanup.
Today I think we're going to do something fun and hopefully interesting, because we're going to address some of the largest misconceptions that we run into essentially on a daily basis about the plastic pollution issue. We got a list here, so shall we get to it?
Yeah.
There's a trash island in the ocean.
We made a whole video actually about that, and that misconception comes from quite a long time ago, and probably from the name itself, like the Great Pacific Garbage Patch. That was a name in the early 2000s. People started to imagine there would be some sort of like floating island in the middle of the ocean, and it's been also referred to as the seventh continent. Unfortunately, it's not quite the case. If it was the case, maybe it would be easier to actually clean up, but as we know, the plastic is very much dispersed over millions of square kilometers. The ocean looks very blue. If you fly above it, you would only see ocean, but as you get closer, you realize that there's bits of pieces of plastic floating all around of every sort of size and shape, and that makes it more like a soup of plastic, more than a trash island.
Plastic in the garbage patches is just microplastics, that is just microscopic pieces, and that also makes it very difficult, if not impossible, to clean up.
Oceanographers started to study plastic pollution. They used what we call surface trawls. So they were collecting initially plankton, and they realized they were starting to have more bits of plastics in their nets than plankton. And that was the base of data collection for plastic in the middle of the ocean. But because the device, the way we were collecting plastic, was targeting small animals like plankton, we were also collecting a lot of like small plastic. So that's really the only sort of samples that scientists were bringing back on shore. So people started to think that it was basically made of uniquely small microplastics. And that's some of the research we've made. And we realized that when you go there, you actually see a lot of microplastics, but there's also a whole lot of larger objects like large nets and crates and buoys that weigh way more than microplastics, right? So in numbers, you will actually find there is more microplastics, but if you look at the mass of plastics, you see that most of it is carried by larger objects.
Every minute, a garbage truck of plastic is dumped into the ocean.
That comes from a study that was published a few years back into Science that's predicted millions of tons of plastics entering the ocean every year. And what we've realized over the last few years and more studies, not only ours, but different groups, that there's probably less plastic entering the ocean on a yearly basis. If you compare it against, you know, measurements, field measurements in rivers and drains, we realize that there's probably one order of magnitude, maybe two orders of magnitude less of plastic entering the ocean. So way less garbage truck entering the ocean every minute.
And then also, I think the framing of one garbage truck of plastic is dumped into your ocean, it suggests like it's kind of this conscious action of just truck after truck. It's much more of a sort of dispersed problem, right? Of like many hands and many people.
But also, it also depends year to year as well, depends, you know, like on floods, on tsunami events, on spills and so on. So actually being able to accurately predict how much plastic is entering the ocean is very complicated. And then it's also about trying to understand what happened to that plastic as soon as it enters the ocean, because what we see is some plastic may be emitted by rivers, but actually most of it is coming straight back onto the shoreline by the action of waves and wind. So really, if you look at the net input of plastic into the ocean, it may be like actually way less than what you think is coming out of your rivers, right? So all the things
in terms of what stays in the ocean.
In terms of what stays in the ocean. So that's and those are a very complicated question to answer, because it will be case by case depending on where you are and when you look at it, and trying to find a sort of like, you know, global number that is accurate is very complicated. So I always say, like, be careful with those sort of estimates.
The plastic at the surface of the ocean represents less than 1% of the total plastic in the ocean.
that is a direct sort of result of overestimating sources of plastic in the ocean. And yeah, like we think there's probably like way more in terms of percentages. Right. At the surface of the ocean, we estimate probably like 1 to 2 to 3 to at most 5 million of tons of plastics floating, right? So that leads to the, you know, the whole question of where is the whole plastic missing, right? So it's been hypothesized that maybe that plastic is at the bottom of the ocean, and there is a lot of plastic at the bottom of the ocean, but probably less, that's what we think there is, right?
Yeah, when you think about it, you know, the most commonly used types of plastic, they're the polyolefins, right? They are positively buoyant.
About 50% of the plastic that is produced is buoyant plastic. Right. So buoyant plastic meaning that it's less dense than seawater and so can be transported over a long distance. The rest may sink the bottom of the ocean, but probably like already in rivers, right. Plastic that sink will end up like at the bottom of the rivers. Mm-hmm. The fate of this plastic is unknown at the moment though.
Right. But in 2050, there will be more plastic than fish in the ocean. The amount of plastic that enters the oceans is probably, you know, factor 10 to 100 lower than what people commonly think. But then secondly, what flows into the ocean, most of that doesn't stay in the ocean. It kind of beaches. So the stuff that actually stays in the ocean, that is like a much tinier fraction, but it definitely sounds dramatic. But people comment this sometimes on sort of the rivers that we're deployed in. People sometimes say like, oh, why are you in that river? Because you have to be in these 10 rivers, because these 10 rivers do like 90, 95% of all the plastic sources. So why is that a misconception?
There was, you know, initial sort of studies trying to predict emissions of plastics from rivers into the ocean. I think first global assessments came in 2017. There were two, and one of them was predicting 10 rivers responsible for 90% of plastic inputs. We made one as well, and I think we were like around 100 rivers contributing 80% of plastic inputs. But those two studies basically were targeting very large rivers as major contributors. But what we found is like over the few like following years, we did like more field work and we realized that smaller rivers, mostly populated small rivers next to the coastline also contribute a large amount of plastic into the ocean, right? So we did this larger assessment maybe like 3-4 years after this initial study, and we realized that there were way more rivers contributing to the problem. At the moment, we believe that there's about 1,000 rivers contributing 80% of riverine emissions of plastics into the ocean.
Mm-hmm. So it's 1,000, probably closer to 1,000 than 10 rivers. Plastic in the ocean predominantly comes from land-based sources. Now, of course, we recently did a study, and when you see our videos of taking these big extractions out of the garbage patch, you know, what you see out there is very different than what we see in our river. So why is that?
One aspect is plastic that is coming from land-based sources, so that would be, you know, coastal areas, that would be rivers, is very likely to come back to shore just after like a fairly like short amount of time in the ocean, and that, you know, would bring like floating plastic would come back to shore with the action of waves and wind and so on, right? Maritime sources, on the contrary, like because plastic may be lost at sea, whether it's from shipping or from fishing activities, will less likely go back to land and can be transported with currents and accumulate in subtropical gyres, like in the Great Pacific Garbage Patch. And so that's one reason why we think within the Great Pacific Garbage Patch, we find mostly actually plastic originating from maritime sources and not from land-based sources, mostly being fishing.
In terms of the absolute amount of plastic sort of touching seawater, you know, most of that comes from rivers, but because that stuff stays in the ocean for a much shorter amount of time. It's really the question in terms of, if you look at the amount of plastic in the ocean right now, at one instant, how much of that is coming from land-based sources versus maritime sources?
Yeah, that's correct. And it's, again, like something that is quite hard to determine. But from observations, at least in the North Pacific, we see that, you know, big, like majority of it is actually not coming from directly from land.
Plastic that's in the ocean mostly comes from developing economies.
Yeah, well, it's not always the case. For instance, if you look into the North Pacific, the debris that we collect in the North Pacific, we look into the origin of that plastic. We know that big fraction of it is coming from fishing activities, but we also look at the markings and evidence and sort of like language that we find on the bits of plastics. And we've identified the main like origins of this plastic is coming from China, from the US, from Japan, from Korea, and those are not developing economies. So it's not always the case.
I guess it's the same thing again, where, you know, from an emissions point of view, it is true, right, that, you know, most of the emissions are coming from lower to middle income countries. But then if you look at the ocean garbage patches, so the fraction of plastic that's persistent in the ocean, that's coming mostly from fishing and therefore more from the more industrialized fishing countries. Mm-hmm. There is this survey done by Gapminder a few years ago that found that 86% of people think that more than a third of plastic waste ends up in the ocean.
There's actually a tiny fraction that end up in the ocean. I mean, first you have, you know, plastic waste, and then you have a small fraction, probably, you know, 10 to 20% will enter the environment. And then out of this, there'll be a smaller fraction that will actually enter the hydrosphere, so like lakes and rivers. And then out of this, a smaller fraction will end up actually being transported all the way to the ocean. And then from there, a small fraction actually will make its way offshore and be transported to you know, like areas like the garbage patch and so on, right? So at the end, you end up with something that is probably like less than 0.1% of plastic waste generated on a yearly basis would actually end up in the ocean. So that's surely a misconception. Plastic itself is very young, and the science of plastic pollution is also very young, and we've learned a lot of things, sure, actually, since we started.
It's important that we, you know, we keep investing in science, and that the stuff that we have learned, that we, you know, face those things and are willing to change our minds of those.